I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
We pray. Thank you very much. We're coming to our session of studying the Word, Bible teaching. And we're looking at the great commandment in the family. I want to remind you that the theme of this retreat is readiness for Christ's coming. And the reason why we're doing this because of what the Lord himself had said. It tells us in Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all the kindreds of the earth will wail because of him. Even so, amen. And then he announces to us, it says, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the ending, says the Lord, which is, and which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. It tells us that the word we're hearing about the coming of the Lord is given out and proclaimed by the Lord Almighty. But it tells us we must prepare so that we'll see him in peace. Revelation chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 25. It says, that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. It's telling us that if there is anything that gets us ready and prepares us, we must hold firmly everything he has taught, everything he has done, everything he has given. This is not the time to hold with loose hands our salvation, our sanctification experience, our holiness experience, or to hold the doctrine of the Bible or the commandments of the Lord with loose hands. If we're going to see him when he comes, it will demand that everything he has given, everything he has done, everything he has performed, we hold with firm hands and not let go. Chapter 3, Revelation, verse 11. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. It says, you can lose your crown. You can lose your reward. You can lose everything you've done, everything he has done, even since you became a believer. He says, if you're not going to lose your reward, you're not going to lose your crown on that final day, the crown of life, the crown of righteousness, the crown which he gives as a reward to the people that love and know him, you will hold that fast which you have, so that that crown will not be lost. Chapter 16, verse 15. Behold, I come as a thief. It's coming suddenly. It's coming unexpectedly. It's coming when many people will not be awake and ready. Blessed is he that watches. Means that you have to be very watchful. There is a Satan around the corner that will lie to take what you have from you. There are thieves around the corner, spiritual thieves they are, that will want to take away what you have. It says, your watch, and you keep your garments, lest you walk naked and see your shame. Chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 12. And behold, I come quickly. It must be definite that Christ is saying this over and over, and he tells us repeatedly, I come quickly, suddenly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. And just before the last verse of the Bible is written, it tells us in verse 20, he which testifies this age says, surely I come quickly. Surely there should be no doubt in your mind, because there's no doubt in the mind of Christ that he is coming. Suddenly he will come. Unannounced he will come. Unexpectedly he will come. At the time when many people are not ready. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. It's on that basis, readiness for the coming of the Lord. It's on that basis, preparedness for the coming of the Lord, that we're looking at every subject, every message in this retreat. And because of that, we're looking at the great commandment that he has given to his family. The great commandment in God's family. In Matthew chapter 22, Matthew chapter 22, reading from verse 37, Matthew chapter 22, verse 37, Jesus said unto him, and Jesus says unto every one of us, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and the great commandment. The Lord Jesus Christ reaffirmed that on the basis of God creating us, because we're creatures of his hand, he made us, he molded us, and because he has given us life, in gratitude to God, the Creator, we ought to love him. Without him, we will not be here. Without his creation, we will not be here. Without his love, his grace, his mercy, that he wants to give existence to us, you and I will not be here. In gratitude to him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. If you have any part of your heart, any part of your life, loving any other sin, the Lord wants to remind you what God created those things. You have a wife, God created her. Husband, God created him. You have a building, God made all those things you use in the building. You have a car, he used everything you use in having that car, he makes that. Even the money you spent. And therefore, because he made you, and because everything you have actually belongs to him, it says, in gratitude, you don't make an idol of any other sin. You don't love any other sin. You don't place your love on those created things. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. By creation, he has the right to demand your love, entire love, complete love, unending love, impartial love, a love that permeates everywhere in your heart by creation. Number two, by redemption. Because he redeemed you, you would have been lost. Whatever you have in this world without his redemption, eventually, you will spend eternity in hellfire. You will be forgotten. Anything you've done on earth, anything you have amassed on earth, there will be no association between you and them. You are dead, you are gone, and you are suffering forever. But, he says, no, you will not perish. I love you, and I'm going to redeem you. I'm going to save you. By creation, he has the right to demand your love. By redemption now, because he's even going to give you heaven, and you're going to live in those mansions on high forever. It says, because of redemption, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. He could have created you and left you on your own. He could have redeemed you, and he could have left you on your own. But it says, because is your sustenance. He's sustaining you And every day is keeping you. He keeps you alive physically. He keeps you alive spiritually. He says you have no other thing to do. He's thinking about you every day. You should be thinking about him every day. He sets his affection upon you every time. You should set your affection upon him every time. He says, by the sufficiency of his sustaining power. Because of the sufficiency of his sustaining grace, you shall love the Lord thy God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and the great commandment. Think about this. What's the first and the great sin? Not to love the Lord your God with all your heart. Not to love the Lord with all your soul. To have a reservation, a part of your heart, a part of your soul, a part of your mind on another thing. Maybe on yourself. Maybe on a man. Maybe on a woman. Maybe on property. Maybe on position. Maybe on any other thing. That will be the first and the great sin. Because that's a sin against the first and the great commandment. It tells us in verse 39. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The Lord is saying, because as I created you, I created him. It's not just existing in isolation. His life belongs to him, me. His life is derived from me. Because of that, not because of who he is, not because of him, because of me who created him. Love him as yourself. I created you, I created him. You love me, you must love him. And because of redemption, when that neighbor now becomes a believer, he is saved by the blood of the Lamb. I count him so precious. I count him so important. I count him so indispensable. And I shed my blood for him because of the love I bestowed on him. Because of my redemption of him, you will love him as yourself. And because I make him to still stay here on earth, I'm sustaining him. I'm keeping him. You cannot look down on him. I am not looking down on him. I appreciate him. I love him. And I am blessing him. You cannot hate the one I love. You cannot hate the one I have redeemed. You love your neighbor. You love your brother. Love your sister as yourself. And then he tells us, on these two commandments hang all the law and the statutes and the prophets. What's that saying? It's saying, number one, every other commandment of God is based on love God, love your neighbor. Every interpretation of the word of God is based on love God and love your neighbor. If you interpret any part of the word of God that allows you to hate your fellow man, hate your brother, hate your sister, that's the wrong interpretation. If you interpret any commandment of God and your interpretation is contrary to loving God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, if it gives allowance, permission to anyone or to yourself to love God partially, to love God half-heartedly, that's a wrong interpretation. Because it says, on these two commandments of loving God and loving your neighbor, on those two commandments hang the law and the prophets. And the Lord gave this in particular to his own children, to his own followers, to his own disciples. And this is the great commandment in God's family. And then we have Matthew chapter 28. I'm reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. All authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. The power here, number one, ability. All ability is given to me. I can do all things. All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. It also means authority. All authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. What does that mean? He has authority over the angels in heaven. He can command them. He can send them forth. He can tell them what to do, because all authority belongs to him in heaven and also in earth. He has authority over everything on earth. He demonstrated that when he was still here on earth. Authority over the sea. Authority over the storm. Authority over all men. Authority over all flesh. Authority over sickness. Authority over Satan. Think about the authority he has over every believer. Again, by creation. Again, by redemption. Again, by sustaining power. He has authority over you. And because he has authority over you, he has authority over your time. All your time. Authority over your skill. All your skill. Authority over your talent. All your talent. He says, go ye therefore, because I have authority. All authority in heaven. All authority on earth. Go ye therefore. And you cannot say, no, I can't go. And then he's asking you, who is in authority over your time, over your talent, over your skill, over your life, over your death, over your eternity, over your existence? No, you cannot say, I cannot, because he has authority. Authority in heaven, authority on earth. And he says, go ye therefore and teach all nations. And the one who has authority over everything in your life and around your life, he is the one. He can take away. He can add all those things that disturb you. All those things that you say, because of this, I don't have time. I'm holding on to this. I have to do this. I have to do this. I have to do this. In a moment of time, he has authority over all those things on earth and in heaven. He can take all that away. And he says, okay, what are you going to do now? Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you. The one in authority and the one who has all power says, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And everybody said, amen. We say amen to his authority. We say amen to his commandment. We say amen to his power over our lives. Great, the great commandment. In God's family, there are three things we're going to examine as we look at this message. Number one, the great characteristics of God's family. Before we can talk about the commandment itself to the family, what's the family of God? Who are in the family of God? Who are the people that belong to that family? How do we know them? How do we identify them? The great characteristics of God's family. Number two, the great commandment in God's family. When you enter into a country, you find out what are the laws of that country. If you live in that country, and if you want to remain in that country, you must understand what are the laws there, the rules there. What is permitted, what is not permitted. On that basis, as you fulfill those laws, you're able to live there. The same thing the